13, verses 1 through 8. Again, 1 Corinthians, verse 13. I mean, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. And it reads, First Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. If everyone has it, please say amen.
Amen.
Chapter 13 reads, if I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanking cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. And the word of the Lord is already blessed.
I am determined. You may take your seat. I am determined to live right. I am determined to give right. I am determined to serve right. I am determined that no matter how much I get knocked down, I'm going to get back up in the name of Jesus. Look at three people and say, I am determined. Lord have mercy. About it on last week. We heard the word last week on last Sunday, and the move of the Holy Ghost took place up in here, and God has called for a shift in the house of Beyond Four Walls Christian Center. And he said that before he would free me to talk about the spiritual gifts directly, before he would free me to be able to do some things, that I had to deal with two different areas, because without these two different areas, the gifts of the Holy Spirit will not work in the house or over the whole house unless there is unity in the house and there is love in the house. I'll look at somebody and say, I feel you on that. I feel you on that. Unless there is unity in the church, unless we are together about who Jesus is, unless we are together about the fact that he's a provider, unless we are together about the fact that he is a way maker and a storm stopper, unless we are together, there is no way that the gifts of the Holy Ghost can manifest and work in the house. Oh, then the second part of that is that it's unity and then it's love. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me right now. It's unity and it's love. And I asked God, I said, God, I said, this is more of a teaching word. Can I just teach it on a Wednesday night? And he said, no, you can't teach it on a Wednesday night, because the whole house will not be present on a Wednesday night. And so you got to teach it on a Sunday morning about the importance of love. I wish I had somebody with me right now. The importance of love. I want you to stand there and proclaim the importance of love, because love is the most important ingredient outside of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Because if you don't know how to love, if you don't know how to love other people, if you only love those who do good to you, I'm here to tell you today, you are missing out on something big, and you are missing out on something awesome as it relates to your relationship with the Lord. I said, God, take this away. I was like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, if this cup could pass by right now, would you give it to somebody? As he said, no, you're going to teach on love. And I started thinking about that word love. Let me hear you say love.
Love,
love. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. The word says that when the man came up on Jesus and said, will you tell me what is the greatest of all commandments? Jesus responded back, love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your mind. And then he said, and also love your neighbor as yourself. Well, some of y'all still sitting there like you're sleeping this morning. Al Green made a great song a few years ago called Love and Happiness. Oh, I got a few of y'all bobbing your heads just then. All I had to do was bring it in. Yes, yes. He said, love will make you do right and love will make you do wrong. Some of y'all know the words. Don't act like that you was tagging club or make you come home early. Sometimes make you stay out all night long. Love and happiness. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me right now. But he says love is important. And so when we look at this word, we see a word that has a great deal of essence to it. We see a word that is deep in meaning. We see a word that's not just a word, but a word that God wants us to put in place. He wants us to do something about love. Because unless I can love you and care about you in the way that Jesus would have me to, I'm missing my blessing. Unless I can love in spite of the way my God does, I'm missing a breakthrough. And you're missing a breakthrough too. But most importantly, the house of God cannot grow and become what God would have it to be. Yes, Paul decides to come at this thing, love, or the importance of love, in order to expound upon the gifts of the Spirit. He decides to come upon it in a different way. He decides to attack it in terms of what love means to activating the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But he does it in a very unique way. Yes, I'm expecting Paul, when he started to talk about love, I'm expecting Paul to lash out at Caesar. When he starts talking about love, I'm expecting Paul to lash out at the tax collector. When he started to talk about love, I'm expecting Paul to lash out at the kings and to lash out at everybody else that's outside of a quote-unquote church. I see I'm having to get down in the hood with y'all right now. But when Paul doesn't go there, when Paul goes there, he doesn't go after the gangbanger when he makes his point about love in verses 1 through 4. When Paul goes there, he doesn't attack the prostitute or the dope dealer or the child molester or the spousal abuser. I wish I had a witness up in here right now. When Paul decides to talk about love, he doesn't attack the rapist, or nor does he attack the racist, nor does he attack the Republicans or the Democrats. No, when Paul, in order to make his boast about the real essence of love and the importance of love to the house and to the people of God, when Paul decides to make his emphasis on love and to have a home his point on love, Paul decides to take a swing at the church. Yes, he does. I wish I had some prayer for with me right now. He decides to take a swing at the church. He decides to take a swing at the believers. He decides to take a swing at the folk that fill up the pews, the folk that get up and high-five everybody. He decides to take a swing at the folk that pay tithes and pay offering. He decides to go after the folks that occupy the sanctuary and claim to be children of God. Paul decides to go out in the church when he makes his point about love. And I can hear somebody saying, Pastor, can you tell me why Paul decides to attack the church? Well, the reason why Paul decides to take a swing at the church to emphasize the importance of the gifts of the Holy Spirit is not just so that the gift can be activated, but Paul decides to do this because he wants to emphasize the point of how important it is that we be together on one front, and that the church could just get together and the church just come together and understand that essence of true love through Jesus Christ, that we could change the atmosphere of the way we have church and the way we serve God. Oh, see, some of y'all just missed that. A few of y'all got that. Paul was calling for a change in the atmosphere. That's what he was doing. And I wish I could have somebody to grab for me right now Psalm number 100 and just read verses 4 and 5 right now, and you will see what Paul was after when he warned about what I say. He wants to change the atmosphere, because unless the atmosphere gets changed, the love that God intended for his house and the love that God calls for through his people will not be received. Look at three people and say, we got to change this atmosphere. Or read verses 4 and 5. Would you please?
gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
I need you to read that one more time.
Gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Paul is saying, I gotta change this atmosphere, and that when you walk into the house of God, you ought to be praising God from the moment that you hit the parking lot. When you walk into the sanctuary, you ought to be on your feet and clapping your hands, that the atmosphere has to be changed. You can't come in here thinking about what bills you gotta pay. You can't come in here thinking about who you used to be mad at. You can't come in here thinking about why you should have stayed at home. That the atmosphere in the house of God, in order for the gift of love, church on Sunday. I'm about to make some folk mad right now, Reverend Rita, because one of the main reasons
and stand up right now and then look back down at your seat and say, excuse me, Caesar. That's my blessed Caesar. And I'm not going to let what came in here on me stay on me. I'm going to get my blessing right now. Is there somebody here that came in here with something on you? Everybody up in here that come in here, get up out of your seat. Let that person get up there. And then I dare you to look back down and say, that's my blessed Caesar.
Of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal.
Lord have mercy, if I got the gift of tongues and I can stand up in the church and I can talk tongues and speak in tongues, which is speaking in another language that the Spirit allows me to do, but I can I have this gift and I don't have love, the noise I made was just empty noise.
If I have the gift of prophecy and fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing.
Lord have mercy. If I got the gift of prophecy and give it to somebody else right now, and I can articulate mysteries. I got all kind of knowledge up in me. I can tell you what God is going to do. I can call for mountains to be moved. There's some folk up in here, you don't even realize you got mountain moving power in your life. That bill that wasn't paid did nothing happen to you. That car that was after, didn't nobody take it. You moved a mountain through your prayer. But if you do all these kind of things, I'm trying to preach this morning and teach at the same time. When you got all this going for you, but you do not love, it's empty. Lord have mercy, it's empty. It's empty. I'm going to tell you how you can have this and not have anything at all in just a minute. Verse number 3.
If I give away all I have,
uh-huh,
and if I deliver my body to be burned,
Lord have mercy,
but have not love, I gain nothing.
Lord have mercy. If I possess, if I give all that I possess to the poor, and give over NIV for me, and give over my body to hardship that I boast about, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Listen to this right now. Let me take you there for a moment. And it's so good. I see a few people here this morning. I'm glad to see some of y'all here. Let me tell you something. It's possible to have gifts, but be misusing them. And therefore, the church cannot accomplish the mission that God intends for it to accomplish. Look at this word. It got real quiet. Just there. It's possible. He names at least 3 spiritual gifts in just verses 1-3. Can I teach for a moment? He says, if I speak in tongues, that's a spiritual gift. If I have the gift of prophecy, that's a spiritual gift. If I have the gift of knowledge, that is a spiritual gift. He's saying that you can possess all of these gifts, that God will give you the gift, and the gift will be there, but it's not doing anything it's supposed to do if you don't know how to love. See, I got to cry right now. If I only prophesy over the people that I like, that's not love. If I only speak to people that I care about or that's in my corner, that's not love. If I only pray for a visit before that pray for and visit me, that's not love. He's saying that real love is the same with everybody. And if God has blessed you with something, if God has blessed you with a gift, that you ought to give everything you have what is he blessed you with, and you ought to love folk the same way he loved you. Oh, I can't flip that around right now. If he loved you enough to give it to you, and he knew you, that's what, he also knew what you wouldn't do with it. But that still didn't stop him from giving it to you. That still didn't stop him from blessing you with it, because it's God's hope and it's his prayer through our son and his son, our Lord and Savior Jesus, that you're going to work with the gift that you got, and you're going to use it to his goodness, and you're going to use it to his greatness, which means that you're going to recognize that God didn't have to do it. You're going to realize that God didn't have to make a way. You're going to realize that God didn't have to bless you in spite of you. And because of the fact that you know who you are and what you are, you're going to turn around and use everything you got in the spirit of love. Because without love, you are not functioning the way you're supposed to be. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me right now. That's why so many folks are in turmoil. That's why so many folks got drama going on in your life, because you got the unity say, I gain nothing. What are you talking about when he says, I gain nothing? He's saying that unless you love through the gifts of the Holy Ghost, you don't really know what love is. Unless your gift is active, you have never really experienced love. I feel that like we make you do wrong, make you do it, make you come over and say, oh, no, love will make you get out of your bed in the middle of the night to make sure that somebody else has something to eat. Love will make you drive across town to make sure that somebody that got a bus pass gets to work or gets to church on time. Love will make you call some folk that you don't want to call and reach out to some people that you don't want to reach out to because you realize that if it hadn't been for God reaching for you right now, love will make you do that. So he attached the church. He said, if the church can't get it right, then how can you talk to the prostitute? How can you talk to the pimp? How can you talk to the gangbanger? How can you talk to the drug addict? If the church can't get it right, if the church where the people walk in and they don't feel comfortable about being here, they got to worry about, well, if I go up in today, how they going to look at me because I ain't been there in a while. Or you know, I was a room. If the church can't get it right, he's saying that we ain't got a shot because the church is the body that has had love poured on it first through the blood of Jesus and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And if we don't know how to love, if we don't know how to teach, if we don't know how to share, if we don't know how to open doors, if we don't know how to feed, if we don't know how to clothe, if we don't know how to bless folks, then how in the heck can we talk about somebody else? Oh my God, help me, Holy Ghost. I'm so tired of folks talking about how bad everything is in Gary, Indiana. Most of the folk that I hear it from is church folk, but newsflash, you ain't done nothing about it. You ain't trying to help nobody. You ain't trying to reach out to nobody. When is the last time you went on the corner and talked to somebody? When is the last time in love you went and counseled a pregnant teen instead of talking about a pregnant teen? When is the last time you went to school and sat out and tried to help somebody understand arithmetic and English? When is the last time you made sure that somebody had enough to eat in their house? That's what Christians do. They know that God is good. See, it's about how much you got, it's what you got. Well, I think I just said something. I heard Jesus tell his disciples one day, I want you to feed the 5,000. And the disciples said, we ain't got nothing but a few fish and a couple of loaves of bread. And Jesus said, bring to me what you got. And then he prayed over the two fish and he prayed over the loaf. And the Bible said the 5,000 folk got fed. Well, guess what? In 2012, he's still doing the same. That he already told me, I want you to teach on this thing. What is love? Verse 5, I just need somebody to read verse number 4 for me, please. What is love? What? Look, somebody said, what is love?
What is love?
Verse 4.
Love is patient.
What is it?
It's patient.
It's patient. It's patient. Love doesn't blow a fuse. Love don't get mad because you came in late. Love don't get mad because your cell phone go off at all hours. Love don't get mad because folks say some things you don't want to hear. Love is patient. I don't understand what you did, but I'm not about to lose my cool with you right now. I might not like what you said, but I'm going to stand here with you right now. I might understand why you keep going back to that relationship that you know you shouldn't be in, but I'm going to hang in here with you like God has hung in here with me. Love is patient. You see, Christianity, you accept Jesus. When you accept him, that's a just like that. The moment you profess his name and confess him, he's yours. But the fact not be. It does not envy. Love does not envy. Man, I can drop a pen. It doesn't envy. I ain't mad because you bought all that hair. And it ain't your hair. It is your hair because you paid for it. Shooting out in place made you mad. Somebody parked in your spot. I I ain't seen a name in the church parking lot yet. I got some folk that'll tell you that's my spot. I pull up a whole lot of times in the spot I think is mine, and it's folk parked in it. I just walk into church and don't say a word. I'm glad I got someplace to park. I got a little bit of it. I'm glad I got something to drive and I got something to park. So I ain't worried about the spot. I'm just glad to be somewhere. I wish I had somebody with me right now. If I had to park 6 blocks now, I thank you, I got a car that can get me here and take me back home. I might have to walk a little bit, but I'm not angry. You think you're mad about everything. And this guy acting like a fool. Lord have mercy. Huh? Go on and tear up your house. Huh? Break all your dishes. Put a hole in your wall. Break your TV. How you gonna watch the NFL game today? Now you gotta get up every time and change the channel. I don't know about you, but I can't live without the remote control. First thing I do after I get out of my car, where's the remote? I try to change you, you get away. Your temperament, love does not anger. It doesn't mean you don't get mad, but you don't get mad to the point where you lose control. You don't get mad to the point. I want to choke some. I used to be that way. Church over here laughing. I'd go to Grove Cemetery Hospital, but I ain't seen you. I tell you this one. I changed on that issue. Stuff used to make me mad don't make me mad no more. People used to make me mad don't make me mad. I was like, man, you know what? I'm sitting up here mad at these folk and thinking about these folk and pretending. And guess what? These folk ain't thinking about me. Guess what? I ain't thinking about you either. I got too much to be grateful for. Well, let me tell you why. Happy birthday, Beyond Four Walls. Regulated counseling to somebody else in this church first. You should always start with your pastor. because the pastor knows who you should talk to, because I'm praying for you night and day. God's speaking to me about you. So when God tells me what you need to do, I know who you need to do. He told me to come to see them. Yeah, I was deep. I just said it, but it's true. It's true. It's true. So he come in. He come in. Come in. He want to sit down. And he started to tell me everything that's wrong. And I stopped him in the middle of that conversation. And I said, I want y'all to do me a favor right now. He said, what? I said, I want you to keep on talking, but I want you to do it in front of my mirror. They start talking, they start, and then they just stop. And they turned and looked at me and said, Pastor, we look like fools. I said, that's what God is saying to you right now. You ain't got no reason to be stupid. You can put that time into, I'm sorry, I love you, I'm about to get better, I'm going to be a different person, I'm going to try it out. I wish I had somebody to want to praise God this morning. I'm talking about love. I'm almost through. I got to give you this word. It's not one of those sermons a day. It's not what I'm saying. It's just about love. He wants you to understand love. Verse 6, somebody else, keeping the record of wrongs. Tell somebody I'm throwing that stuff away. Now, I want to bless the house right now before somebody else agrees for me. These must be for me for verse 6. I want to bless the house right now today. I want everybody in here that's ready to get rid of your records of wrong. Come up here, whether you got it, I can tell you that, and just throw it down here on the altar and go back to your seat. I mean, I want you to give God a praise right now. Throw away your record of wrong. That stuff you've been keeping a record of. Yeah, you lost the money. You ain't going to ever get it back. Yeah, you did good and they beat you. A record. They didn't say it. They talked about you. A record. Throw your record of wrong. There you go. That's just stuff. Throw it away. I'm going to throw away a shovel for. Throw your record of wrong. I'm going to throw it away. My record of wrong. The wrong stuff that happened to me. It's a bad stuff. Keeping this stuff too long. I've been holding this stuff too long. I've been keeping it in too long. You got years and years of scar and baggage over you. Talking about you want a husband or want a man. God can't give you nobody else because you hold on to the past too tight. Can't bless you with another person. You got the scars and baggage. Hey, it's over now. It's by. Reverend Rita says, see ya. Why should you have a record when he forgives you for yours? When you say, I'm sorry, God is done with it. When you say, forgive me, he's over it. If I could get about 15 people today to believe that, we have the church up in here right now. When you intercede on behalf of somebody else and tell, I want you to forgive them, real quiet again. You want to be blessed? Intercede and pray for the folk that harm you. Pray for the folk that have hurt you. Ask God to forgive the folk that have done it to you. When you want to get deliverance, you look at the deliverance standing right here. When you do that and you go there, God will take you to places and open up doors for you, and folk will be trying to figure out where to get. And in your head, they'll keep on lying. I helped them get that door open. I helped them do that. And you can look and say, you didn't do that. God did that. I'm almost done. Verse 7.
6-7.
Six. I'm sorry. Come on.
Love does not delight in evil.
What? What? Love. You ain't glad that somebody lost their house? You not happy today marriage fell apart? You not glad that they finally got this? You mean you ain't supposed to have that kind of mentality? Love doesn't delight you. When something bad happens to somebody, it ought to tug on your heart. It ought to change your spirit. It ought to make you want to be sympathetic toward them. You ought to want to reach for them at that moment the same way God does for you. Yes. Love doesn't delight in evil. Something bad happened. Somebody can't find a way. Somebody lost something. Something happened to somebody. Love doesn't rejoice in that. Somebody call you the phone. See, girl, you finally got your revenge. Yeah, well, guess what? That ought not happen. You'd be like, I'm getting off the phone with you. I'm not being cursed by that kind of mentality. I'm not happy about somebody else's tragedy. You bringing curses on yourself with that stuff. You cursing your household. Look at somebody say, it's not that kind of sermon.
I want you to talk about love today. I got people here today that just need love. Love does not delight in evil, but what does it do?
But rejoices with the truth.
It rejoices with the truth. What's the truth? God is able. God is a way maker. What's the truth? He blessed me in spite of me. I wish I had some. All of y'all should have stood up right then, because everybody here knows that something about you is not right. Even today, I don't care what title is in front of your name or behind your name. I don't care if you just recently got married. There's some things about you that when you think about how good God is, you ought to just rejoice, because He didn't put you on Front Street, because He didn't put you on Black. You're just happy and you're just glad He didn't keep your stuff in the closet and not let folks know who you really are. I'm glad about the truth that I did deserve it, but He did do it. I'm glad about the truth that I ain't no good, but He's still a good God. I'm glad about the truth that Jesus is a way maker and a provider. I'm glad about the truth that I wouldn't have nothing if it wasn't for the Lord on my side. I'm glad about the truth. Somebody say that's the truth.
That's true.
Verse number 7. What does love do?
It always protects.
Oh my God. Oh my God. It always protects. Oh, come stand in the chair. Stand in the middle. In the middle. Give me 5 people to stand around me. Go toward the front a little bit more, Chip. We'll still move to move forward. Give me 5 or 7 people to stand around me. Give me some more people to stand around. Just stand around me. Just stand around me in a circle. Get all around me. Pretend that that's you in the middle right there. That's you in the middle. And instead of everybody taking a shot at you when something happened to you, that's what we ought to do for each other. We ought to protect one another. We ought to protect one another. I hear something happen to you all. I ought to be just like that. And we ought to hold hands. We ought to hold hands. And we ought to keep the enemy out. We ought to lock the devil up. We ought to make sure that the bad situations don't get worse, because we realize that the same way we bless him is the way you're going to bless us. And the same thing that happened to him could be happening to you right now. But we're going to rally around the cross right now, because God has been so good. And we're going to put our gifts together. We're going to put our spiritual power together. And we're going to pray this thing out. And we're going to pray this thing through. And we're going to do whatever we have to do in order to be able to make it. You ought to thank God for the protection that he gives you. You see, you're looking at humans, but that's what God does every day for you. It's some things that didn't happen to you last week that was supposed to happen.
Trust you until I get what I need. I'm going to trust you until you answer my prayer. I'm going to trust you until
speeds. It always perseveres. Or reach up and say, I'm going to hang in here. I'm going to hang in here. Or some hanging here folk in this world. It's the folk up in here right now. Lenny, you know what I'm talking about. I'm going to hang in here. The world is saying, but I'm going to hang in here. I'm not going nowhere. I'm going to hang in here. Your word is good enough for me. I'm going to hang in here. What you've done already in my past is enough for me. I'm going to hang in here. How you made a way out of no way. That's why I'm going to hang in. I'm going to persevere. I'm going to have some scars on me. I might get talked about. I might get walked on. I might get a black eye. I might lose my reputation. Some folks might give, say something about my character. But guess what? I'm going to persevere. And I'm going to hang in here. Because I know if I hang in here, you just got me going through a test right now. I'm trying to tell somebody something right now. The stuff that you are going through, you think it's a bad situation. But God is just getting you out there because he's getting you ready. And he's getting you ready for a bigger thing. He's getting you fixed up for a bigger blessing. He's preparing you for a bigger breakthrough. And the stuff you're going through right now, it's called tribulation. But anytime you go through tribulation, you end up with a testimony. Because you can tell somebody about your tribulation through your testimony that God is. Does anybody know that he is? How about through you to tell he is?
Love.
Always persevere. And number five, another verse 8, and I'm through. Love
never fails.
It never fails.
But where there are prophecies,
just right there, love, it never fails. I'm going to say that again until somebody gets it. Love, because we're not talking about any old kind of love. We're talking about the love of God. It never fails. See, just because it didn't work out the way you wanted it to, don't mean that it didn't happen. It just meant that God knew it was best not for it to happen. Just because you've been delayed don't mean you've been denied. I wish I had somebody with me, right? Love never fails. Love never fails. The love of God never fails. He will never let you down. He will never turn his back on you. He will never stop caring about you. He will never leave you barren. He will never leave you homeless. He will never leave you broken. Love never fails. Real love never fails. So if God never gives up on you, then why should you give up on somebody else? If God never gives up on you, why should you throw in a towel? You ought to realize that love never fails. So here's what I want to do right now. I'm being obedient to God right now. I want to have a prayer right now offered up over the whole church, and I'm going to cut this word off, because without unity and love, the spiritual gifts cannot come into play. And somebody up in here today, the real love of God, the power of God through love has not been what it should be in your life. And I'm asking you to stand up all over the church today, or maybe you have a relative today that needs this and you interceding for them. They're not here today. Love never fails. I want you to know God is not going to let you down. I want you to know you have not been shut out. I want you to know he has not turned his back on you. But we can't get this done without unity and love. It's got to be love. Reach across the aisle. Reach across the aisle. Reach across the aisle. Or behind you, right behind you. I don't care how you reach. He told me there was a whole house open, a whole bunch of open today that needed to just hear about love. You forgot about love. You put so much priority on being in church, that's good. But without love, the house not going to be able to make it. Without love, you're not going to be able to forgive somebody, so you're blocking your forgiveness. Without love, that power and authority that you need, you are not going to have, because love never fails. Now, I want everybody that's here today that feels like you've been left out on something to tell somebody, excuse me, and come stand down front. Anybody here that feels like you've been left out on something, come down front. You've been left out. You've been left out. Love never fails. You've been left out. Maybe it's from a relationship you had with your parent that was never there for you the way you feel like you've been left out. Maybe because of the way you've been praying, you feel like you've been left out. Maybe because of the way things haven't gone
left out. Were you getting ready to come down front? Was he getting ready to come down front? Lord have mercy. I need all of my people in the church to feel like you've been left out. You've been standing on this word, but you haven't seen it yet. I want you to know that love never fails. You've been praying for something. You said, God, I don't understand how you could let everybody else have gotten this already and left me. I want you to know today that love never fails. You've been looking for justice, but God said, I am your justice. Love never fails. You've been holding a hurt against a parent that wasn't there for you. Love never fails. It never fails. Never fails. Never fails. Love never fails. Never fails. Now, I need everybody down front to hold hands. I need everybody in the church to hold hands because, see, our gifts are as strong as our unity and our love is. It's not too late to come. Amen. God bless you. It's not too late to come. Our love is as strong as our unity and the love that we have for one another. Unless we can love one another, unless we can pull for one another, God bless you. It's not too late. Unless we can care about one another, unless we can. I just want you to hold a person's hand you got, lift it up. And we in this together. Yeah, together. Together. This love that God is calling for, it's a unique love. It's an agape love. He said, I want you to learn how to love the way I love you. I want you to treat people the way you want me to treat you. I want you to care about the sins of this world the way I care about yours. I want you to care about this community the way I care about your household. I want you to care about this congregation the way you look after your own kids. I want you to seek my face, and I want you to know that when you do it, I will never let you down because love never fails. Somebody today, you had a big mountain in your life. Love never fails. Somebody here this morning right now, you didn't come yet, but you ought to come now because you're in a valley and you don't want nobody to know it. I dare you to just break loose from the person's hand you hold to come down front and join everybody else because I'm telling you, love never fails. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. There are at least two more like that. There are at least two more like that that'll come through. There is two more like that. There's one. Where's the other one? Somebody's moving. Somebody here's moving already. I don't know where you are. You're moving. I see it right now. Come on. There we go. Never fail. Never fail. Never fail. Lord have mercy. Take her by the hand. Let her come in here. Amen. Take her by the hand. Amen. I want you to believe that the shift that God is calling for is a shift that has to do with your mind and your heart. He said, you take your heart off of the things in this world that concern you and put your heart on me through unity and love, and I will activate the gift that is in you, and the gift that is in you will fight your battles. The gift that I have put in you will be your shield. The gift that I placed in you will be your anchor. The gift I put in you will give you the power to say yes when you want to say no. The gift I want to bless you with, but it starts with love. But you got to believe that I never fail. See, so I do it the way you want to be done. Don't mean that I shortchanged you. I did what was best for you. And I'm still going to do what's best for you. I won't fail. I won't let you down. I shall not fail you. He's telling me to talk to somebody. I won't fail you. I will not let you down. I'm not going to let you down. I'm not going to turn my back. I'm not going to fail you. So I need you to step up this morning with your heart. I need you to step up with your commitment. I need you to step up with your soul and trust me and love me back the way I love you. Father God, I'm asking you right now to touch. I'm asking you right now to move right now. You said through your word that we can possess all kind of things, but unless we love it, then we have nothing. You said in your word that love is patient and love is kind and love is slow to anger. And so I'm asking you, Father God, for that angry person here today, dear Lord God, that you would take that away from that selfish person. I want you to take that away from want you to take that away. From that jealous person, I want you to take that away. From that person that feels shortchanged, I want you to take that away right now. I want you to move all over the house right now and let your people know that they are loved because you are sitting on the throne, moving in through your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus. You are looking down on your people right now, and you are crowning heads right now, and you are moving mountains right now. I want you to let your people know that you are adjusting a workforce right now, that you're getting a desk ready, and you're getting a seat ready. I want you to let somebody know today that's unemployed that you're getting their name prepared on a time card that's going out of time clock with it. I want you to let somebody here today know that the greatest gift they can have is the gift of love. And so I ask that you would come over the hearts this morning, Father God, and let somebody here know that the reason why you miss it is because you are loving. And we're going to let go of envy, and we're going to let go of strife, and we're going to let go of past hurts, and we're going to let go of everything of the past, and we're going to seek your face with all our hearts. Oh, come on right now, God. We need you right now. We ask you to come on and take over our lives right now. We pray over every area of our lives right now because we believe that you cannot fail. We believe that you are making a way. We believe that you are moving right now, and we believe we can put all of our trust in you. Father God, right now I'm asking for a house that will begin to trust you and understand that together we can change the world, that together we can change the community, that together we can change our household, that together we can make provisions for our children, that together we can stop violence, that together with our prayers and our unity and our gift, there's nothing that this church can't do. So right now, Father God, if anybody that's got a health issue, Lord have mercy, I want you to heal them right now because you cannot fail. But somebody's got trouble in their home, I want you to touch that home right now because you cannot fail. But that person having trouble with their children right now, I want you to bless the child in all areas. If there are people around the child that are distracted, I want you to bless them too because you cannot fail. But that person that doesn't think that you're able, I want you to move on their mind and heart this morning and show them there's nothing that's too hard for you because you cannot fail. For that person with a broken heart, put that heart back together right now because you cannot fail. For that person that walked in here mad about something and thought they had a valid point, take that away from them today and replace it with love because you cannot fail. So move right now and touch right now and have your way right now, and we give you the honor and glory right now over the whole house and the whole sanctuary because you cannot fail. It's because of your unfailing love right now that as we prepare to walk away from this altar, we prepare to turn loose of hands, we're going to do it with minds and hearts that have a complete faith and a complete trust in you, that the activation of the gift of the Holy Spirit are moving in us right now, and we're going to fight back through our gift, and we're going to claim victory over areas we thought we were defeated. We're going to claim victory over bills and debt. We're going to claim victory over anything that has been a burden in our life because you cannot fail. And so right now, all over the church, I just ask that we would start to give you a praise. I just ask all over the church that we would give you a worship. I ask right now that we just give you the glory.
Love, real love, the love of God has transformed you and has transformed this house. And on this day, your life will never be the same because love will take you through. Amen. Touch three people as you go back to your seat and say, I got that love. I've got that love. Recommit your life back to the Lord. I dare you to get up because you got that love. Is there anyone? Man, woman, boy, or girl, today, that just wants to come and commit or recommit your life, just come stand down front.